Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank the ladies for that wonderful a cappella rendition of the hymn from our hymnal. Very beautifully done. Thank you so very much. Well, it's good to be with you today, and I thank you for joining us here on our Zoom. I'm going to go ahead and just get a little clock going so that I can keep tabs of what's going on with time. And I'd like to wish you a happy Sabbath, brethren. In recently reading through the Gospel of Luke, our East Bay Bible study did that, you know, kind of as a interim assignment over the Thanksgiving holiday week. A scripture jumped out at me like never before. And that scripture is one that, when I think about it and meditate on it, is super, super impactful, not only to us as Christians, but to the world as a whole. And the passage was in Luke chapter 1, verse 79, and the specific phrase that struck me so powerfully was about our being guided to the path of peace. That kind of ties in a little bit with the opening remarks that we had today from, you know, our welcomer. The full passage is in Luke chapter 1, and it starts off in verse 67. So if you have a Bible, why don't you pop it open there, and let's read through that passage together, because I think the context is important. Luke chapter 1 and beginning in verse 67. And the context is the birth of, you know, the individual named John, who would be known later on as John the Baptist, right? And his father, Zacharias. The scripture goes to say, it says, now his father, Zacharias, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, blessed is the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets who have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. The oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. Verse 76, and you, child, this is referring to John, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins. Verse 78, through the tender mercy of our God, with which the dayspring from on high has visited us, referring to Jesus Christ, to give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death. And this is the statement that jumped right out off of the pages of my Bible at me, to guide our feet into the way of peace. I don't know about you, but with the COVID circumstances, the election circumstances, the unrest in our streets, all the different changes that are going on in society and lockdowns and whatnot, I was not feeling very peaceful for quite a while. There was a stirred upness. I don't know if that's really a word. If it wasn't, then I claim it. I just coined it. If it is, then hopefully I used it appropriately. The New Living Translation, which I was reading this verse out of, uses the term to guide us to the path of peace. So guide our feet into the way of peace is the New King James, and guide us to the path of peace is the New Living Translation. And I think both have their resonance. Just finish out that portion of scripture. Verse 80 says, so the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his manifestation to Israel. You know, in looking into this passage, I started meditating on it. I wanted to know more about it. Again, it just struck me that there's something here. What is it that's here in this passage that talks about being guided to the path of peace? I looked into it, and it actually ties back to a passage that a lot of people are, you know, citing this time of year, Isaiah chapter 9. Isaiah chapter 9. Why don't you pop back there in your Bible with me, and let's go to Isaiah chapter 9, and we'll start reading in verse 2. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 2. Verse 2 begins, it says, the people who walked in darkness. What was the situation that was referred to by Zacharias in Luke? People in darkness, right? The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, it goes on in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death, again, something else that was also cited in Luke. Upon them, a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and garments rolled in blood, kind of a vision there, will be used for burning and fuel of fire. Not good times going on there. But this is what's cited today, right, in this time frame. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. There's a new thing that's happening here. And there will be a change. And the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Verse 7, of the increase of his government and the increase of the peace of that government that he will institute, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. And how will this be accomplished? The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. The name of this being, right, is Prince of Peace. And his government will have an increase of peace. Again, there's a tie-in here between that comment, that short phrase in Luke, to what's being talked about here in Isaiah. So today I would like to leverage off of these verses, and specifically the phrase in Luke chapter 1, verse 79, and speak to you about one of the fruits of the Spirit, and drill in a bit on what Scripture says about how we should be viewing, as the New Living Translation puts it, the path of peace. Peace. We all likely know by heart where we find the list of the fruit of God's Holy Spirit in Scripture, with peace being the third listed attribute there. No need to turn there, but in Galatians 5:22, it begins, but the fruit of the Spirit is, right? And then these things are listed out. In Albert Barnes' New Testament commentary, has this to say about the following attributes that come after that phrase. It begins by referring to the list as that which the Holy Spirit produces, denoting that these things do not flow from our own nature. The vices mentioned earlier are the works or result of the operations of the human heart, right? The works of the flesh. But the virtues which he now presents in that passage are produced by a foreign influence, the Holy Spirit. It's an interesting way of putting that. Paul does not trace them to our own hearts, even when our hearts are renewed. He says that they are to be regarded as the proper result of the Spirit's impact on us, as the result of reconciliation with God. The point is that these are not physical skills. They come by the power of the Holy Spirit, the helper that God promises to those that change their lives, who overcome sin, that become baptized, and continue their walk with Him. That last statement from the commentary tells us that peace is not simply the absence of conflict, but must be a deeper, more permanent state. Has something taken your peace? Has all the machinations and the riffraff and the circumstances of lockdown and desiring to do things that are now, you know, precluded from us being able to do them, has that stolen your peace? Mankind often uses the word peace to describe a state where they have stopped fighting. They have agreed to a ceasefire, a peace treaty, or an accord has been signed. But a sense of peace through reconciliation means to be set at one again, like we would think of the word atonement. It means that hearts have been changed from worried and defensive or greedy, I've got to get all the toilet paper that's on the shelf, and aggressive, right? Or to one of calm and concern for others. No, you go ahead and take the toilet paper. I'll get the next batch. It's okay. Of generosity and reconciliation, more than just the absence of violence or conflict. In a sense, the marriage relationship is an effective example to consider in this light. Many marriages are in trouble today because they are not reconciled. They are not in agreement or at one. You know, men and women, what does the old book say? Men are from Venus, women are from Mars, or vice versa. I can't remember which one it was. I read the book, I have to tell you, but I can't remember which way it was. They think different. There's different approaches. There's different perspectives. There's different feelings. But there is supposed to be a coming together and a desire to have a life together on one track, right? In an agreement. Just because a couple isn't embroiled in an open disagreement at any given moment doesn't mean they have peace in the relationship. We need to learn to be settled in order to find that kind of peace. John 14, verse 27 says, "Let not your heart be troubled," right? The word troubled is agitated or uncertain. Kind of like I was feeling early on in the COVID interfaces and all the other things that were going on in the background that I opened up with. It says, neither let it be afraid. You know, we need to remember that we have the opportunity to ask our loving Father for that kind of calm in our lives. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Asking for calm, asking for the kind of peace that only God can provide to lead us in the path of peace, the way of peace, that the Prince of Peace has in mind for us is something we can ask for. We need to be spiritually minded, to have the mind of Christ in us. Again, Prince of Peace is a title that will be on him, that is on him. And this is all something we need to do as we live in an unpeaceful world. Romans chapter 8, verse 6 says, to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So now we're starting to see a little bit about how we can come about aligning ourselves to walk in the path of peace. We need to fill our mind and structure our lives to be in alignment with the facets of God's character, to overcome and weed out the carnality that surrounds us, to transform our way of thinking, our mindset, our approach, our view of the sovereignty of God and his capability of provision. Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3 says, you, speaking of God, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Where's the focus? The focus is on God. The focus is on God's way. The focus is on trusting in God. What's interesting here is that this word translated here as peace, in fact, the word for perfect peace is just one word, one Hebrew word, shalom. The word shalom is what's translated perfect peace. Other places it's translated peace or security. And what's interesting, it is, you know, it's such a big word with so much meaning. It can also mean tranquility. And it can certainly mean peace. But it also means a sense of being complete. There's a completeness that we can have. There's a sense of rest, a sense of health that goes along with this word, shalom. So, you know, it's no wonder they translated it perfect peace. They had to have another word to put it in there because, you know, just this, what we have in our minds is what peace is not enough, right? It's got to be perfect peace because it's a gift from a perfect God. In this light, let's take a look at how prevalent peace is in God's word. Peace is really all over the place in God's word. You know, some statistics I found in the Strong's, there are 19 different words in the Bible which are translated as peace throughout the scriptures. There's 13 words in the Old Testament and 6 in the New Testament. And the words translated actually as peace appear 429 times overall, with 318 of those in the Old Testament and 111 in the New Testament. And kind of like what we see with the word shalom, those same words, which also may be translated as other words, also appear another 1,323 times altogether. So I'd say, you know, it's pretty safe to say that this qualifies as a major theme of Scripture. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, tells us that this is what we are called to. I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the calling with which you are called. Verse 2, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Brethren, we're supposed to be walking in the path of peace. We are to be bonded, the Spirit in the bond of peace with one another. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33. For God is not the author of confusion, quite the contrary, but of peace. Confusion is a state of disorientation, of uncertainty. Instead, God intends our minds and our hearts to be organized, rested, reconciled. Another passage, Isaiah chapter 32, verse 17. And, you know, I apologize, brethren, that I'm not, you know, taking the time to turn to all these. I know you're probably flipping around and, you know, working your fingers to the bone trying to get to these really quick. There's so many scriptures. I'm not going to go through all of them, but there's so many that I want to get to so that we get this sense of the encompassing essence of what's being talked about in scripture. Isaiah 32, 17, and the work of righteousness shall be peace, and the effect of righteousness shall be quietness and assurance forever. How do these scriptures resonate with us as we read them? Is it something that we can look through and see elements of what's already existing in our lives? Is it something that we look at and say, you know, I can use a little bit more of that? Something grabbed a hold of me as I read that passage in Luke chapter 1, verse 79, and said, James, you need to look into this. You need to get more of that in your life. You need to get onto that path. I hope that I'm talking with folks that are like me that can hear that call and want to get on the path of peace, directed by the Prince of Peace. You know, we can go to Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, often referred to as the blessings and the cursing chapters, to see God's instruction to the children of Israel. He told them how he wished them to live their lives. You know, and those passages apply to us today as well. Leviticus 26, verses 3 through 4, and also verse 6, says there, if, right, a big if. That I like what Mr. Karamidjian says about if. It's the biggest little word in the English language. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and perform them, then I will give you rain in its season. And he goes on to speak of the blessings of prosperity that will come from that. But more importantly to our point, verse 6, I will give peace in the land, and you shall lie down, and none will make you afraid. I will rid the land of evil beasts, and the sword will not go through your land. So part of the keeping of God's statutes and his commandments will result in peace. God's word describes security and peace. If people will serve him, remain faithful to his instruction, and maintain purity in their worship, there will be security and peace. You know, Psalm chapter 46 tells us repeatedly in only 11 short verses that God is our refuge, our sanctuary, a place to escape the drama, to be safe and comforted and at peace. And this passage, I think, you know, let's turn there together and let's read Psalm chapter 46 together. Because we need this, brethren. If you're looking for peace in the world right now, there might be pieces, places where there's some peace, but I don't think you're going to find it long term out there. And definitely you would not be in the path of peace if that's where you're looking to direct your feet. Chapter 46 of Psalm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. A key to knowing peace is in the first part of verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. Step back for a moment. Grasp what really matters, who's really in charge, and find peace in that. Chapter 6, verse 24 says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you." And what? "And give you peace." Where does peace come from, brethren? It comes from God. He is the only source of peace that's truly peace. As we look into the pages of the Bible, we see directions from God that point us to developing a peaceful spirit. Many of God's servants made it a point to greet others with this specific blessing to keep God's people focused on one of the greatest blessings that has been given to us. A greeting of peace was a common trait for God's early ministers to the churches they served. Paul was particularly fond of wishing this blessing upon them. And in Romans chapter 1, verse 7, I'll just give you that as an example. "To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." Conveying a blessing of peace from God outward toward the brethren there. Both books to the Corinthians begin in similar manner. Galatians 1:1 also says, "Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead." Verse 2, "And all the brothers with me to the churches of Galatia, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." And over again in Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, both books to the Thessalonians, both Timothy's, Titus, Philemon, over and over, this blessing of grace and peace were conveyed. You know, it wasn't just Paul that was inspired to greet the brethren with this specific, you know, wish for them. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ," and we'll break into verse 2, "may grace and peace be yours in the fullest measure," it says there. You know, there's a similar opening statement in 2 Peter. And Jude, the book of Jude, who is general enough that, you know, he could be writing to us, which in effect, you know, he is. Jude chapter 1, verse 1, "Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ." Verse 2, "Mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you." Do you accept that as coming towards you from your brother Jude, who lived so many centuries ago? Something to think about, brethren. And also think about, are we able to convey it outward to others also? Are we able to receive it, but are we also able to convey that concept, that thought? You know, and then there's also John, also writing under inspiration in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. And go ahead and turn there. Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. Verse 4, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, what's he say? Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. John pays it forward and says, grace to you and peace from himself? No, from him who is and who was and who is to come. Jesus Christ. Very impactful. Very impactful. Let's take a moment here and consider a question. Who do we develop the fruits or traits of the Holy Spirit for? You know, with peace being one of those in particular we are focusing on. When we read God's word, we might sometimes come to focus on our development as a personal process. Much of the direction we receive can seem like it's, you know, pointed at us in a rather personal way. Do this, don't do that. You know, thou shalt or thou shalt not, right? But the biblically outlined peace that we're seeing, you know, come forth. And indeed, all the fruits of the Spirit are not to be bottled up and hidden away like a treasure, right? They are to be practiced openly by disciples of Christ, as he did himself. You know, we can turn to an example of that in John chapter 14. John chapter 14 and in verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace, the Prince of Peace, leaves peace. His peace, he says, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Then it goes on. That word give means to bestow, to grant as from a position of power, like the monarch bestows knighthood or a university bestows an honorary degree. It's a powerful thing. It's handing over something of usefulness. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Prince of Peace, the government that will increase peace, grants us this gift. Christ said, my peace I give you. Have we taken the time to receive that? Do we feel like we fully received it? Is it internalized in us? Is it exuberant from us? Do we feel like we're walking in the path of peace? Are we guided with our footfalls to step on the path of peace? You know, Christ saying, my peace I give you, that should give us a little bit of a tip about what we're supposed to do with it in turn. Developing the fruits of the Spirit, including peace, are not just to feed us personally. They are for us to also be able to give and to share forth of. Christ didn't say we should take this peace just so we could escape the drama of this life, to put on our spiritual blinders, insert our spiritual earbuds, withdraw into some kind of spiritual cocoon, just basking in the glow of serenity and peace all by our lonesome. Imagine if Christ had withdrawn and not shared his peace, not spread the gospel of peace. There would still and always be just two in the family of God if that was the approach. No, Christ left us a legacy of caring and sharing and helping as we have opportunity. James chapter 2, verse 15 says, if a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, verse 16, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and be filled, and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Have you really conveyed peace by saying the words, go in peace and be warmed and filled? Fail, right? There needs to be actions associated with the path of peace. Think of the fruits and consider that they are to be pointed toward others. Love is outgoing concern. Faithfulness is to be practiced in how we interact with man and God. The benefit of gentleness is when it is shown to those around us. Psalm 34, verse 14 says something a little bit about peace. It says, depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. This phrase describes an emotional and mental effort to find something, to run after it, to chase it, or to hunt it. John Wesley's notes on the Old and New Testament says this of the term. Do not only embrace it gladly when it's offered, right? Just going to sit back and passively just have peace come my way. But follow hard after it, even when it seems to flee away from you. Are we being guided and directed and energetically looking to be on the path of peace? Hebrews 12:14 kind of bolts onto this. It says in verse 14 of Hebrews 12, strive for peace with all men and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. And there's kind of an interesting analogy that comes from the commentary on that passage, Adam Clark's commentary to be exact. It says, pursue peace with the same care, attention, and diligence as beasts do their game, right? So you got like a lion or a leopard or, you know, something else that's like kind of chasing down, you know, some game, maybe a cat, you know, trying to get a mouse or a bird or something. You know, they're taking their diligent time and attention and they're carefully lining things up for the best possible, you know, capacity to pounce on that game. Follow it through all places, trace it through all winding circumstances, and have it with all men if you can, while not sacrificing obedience to God's law. We're to pursue peace, hunt it down. You know, and those who work for peace are people who accurately reflect the character and nature of God. Being a peacemaker is restoring balance, restoring wholeness, and soundness. Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. You know, we've heard many messages on, you know, the Beatitudes. And chapter 5, verse 9 specifically says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Christ didn't give us his peace for us to close out the world, to live in a cocoon until he returns. It is a fruit we are to develop and share, to give to others as he gave to us. In Genesis chapter 26, there's an example of a peacemaker, you know, that I'm not giving you an assignment, but if you care to look into it and want to kind of see the dynamics of how peace can come about, you can read that later in Genesis chapter 26. But the story is about Isaac, you know, he's been blessed by God, just as his father Abraham was, with flocks and productive lands and servants. His wealth and prosperity earn him the envy of his neighbors, the Philistines, who stop up his wells out of jealousy. Wells were the primary water source in the desert region, right? The sole means for watering livestock and supplying the people encamped in the area. By plugging up Isaac's wells, the Philistines were threatening his livelihood, forcing him into a corner to either fight or move on. Isaac certainly had recourse to fight back, but what did he do? Isaac kept or made, more importantly, I think we could say he made peace. In fact, chapter 26 shows that Isaac chose to move more than once in order to avoid strife. Each time, God blessed him with productive wells. And finally, God blessed him with a place where he could be at peace. This actually was an excellent example of what we find in a New Testament passage. Romans chapter 12, verse 18. What does it say there, brethren? It says, if it is possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Isaac applied that before Romans 12, 18 was ever written. You know, some in our society today frown on people who try to keep the peace, perceiving them as weak or timid for not standing up and fighting for their quote unquote rights. While we don't want to let others treat us like a doormat, we also don't have to assert ourselves every time life presses in on us. And, you know, right now, life is pressing in on us. You know, we saw earlier that peace was a favorite topic of Paul's writing, but it wasn't simply a standard way of greeting the congregations he wrote to. Romans 14 addresses the issue of foods offered before idols and the issues that some struggled with. But notice what Paul focuses on, right? He focuses on the spiritual aspects of our futures. In Romans chapter 14, verses 17 through 19, he says, "For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit." Verse 18, for he that in these things serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved of men. Verse 19, let us therefore follow after these things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another. Seek after, follow after, employ in your lives those things that make for peace. Walking the path of peace. You know, I'd like us also now to focus in on some scriptural instances of the phrase, God of peace. God of peace. You just type that into your, you know, e-sword, or if you have a concordance somewhere, just look up the phrase and you'll find, I found five instances where it comes up. Romans 15, verse 33 says, now the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Indicating a blessing of God being with people, but also indicating that part of the nature of God is peace. Romans 16, verse 20, and the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. It doesn't sound very peaceful, right? But he's going to make peace by putting down rebellion. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 9, he says there, the things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, right? And the God of peace will be with you. So it comes, God of peace being with us and helping us walk in the path of peace, comes with some application. We have to apply ourselves to some degree, but it's a gift, right? There's some application, there's some response, there's some energy, But it's truly a gift to have the peace that only God can provide. The fourth one of these is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. And it says in there, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit," this wholesomeness, right, this all-encompassing element, "and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Man, I read that, I want that. There's something to that verse in Luke chapter 1, verse 79. It just keeps cranging in my head. And the last one that I found was Hebrews 13, verses 20 and 21. And it says there, "Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." In conclusion, brethren, the theme and characteristics of peace in the Bible and how we should be viewing these attributes in our own walk toward God's kingdom are just simply so awesome to meditate on. You and I live in a great paradox. We have been called to experience peace in the midst of a conflict-filled world. You know, the God of this age, small g, he's not going to go away quietly, right? There will be conflict. But we can be led in the path of peace. We can have the beauty of the gift of peace from our God. Romans 3, verse 17 and 18 tells us, "And the way of peace have they," the peoples of this world, right? "The way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes." Step one, have an awe of our God. This world won't know peace if the fear of God is missing from their lives. And God is not even in the public square anymore. God's not even in the conversation at this point in most of society. And when he's brought up, he's looked at in a little manger, right? Or he's looked at as being dead on a cross. Not as, you know, Christ living, powerful at the right hand of the Father. You and I have been called to have our natures changed by the indwelling of God's Spirit. That means we must develop peace of mind as a way of life. We are going to experience anxieties and conflict. We just can't escape that. It's just all around us. John 16, verse 33 says, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." It's the peace of mind, right? And the mind of peace, walking in the path of peace, being led in the way of peace, that we must be striving to develop. God instructs us to become peacemakers on our way to becoming his children. Let's turn to our closing scripture in the book of 2 Peter. 2 Peter and chapter 3. And here Peter was reminding us as God's people that this world and its difficulties will someday come to an end and be replaced by a world and government of righteousness. Knowing this, he encourages us with the following. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11 and verse 14. "Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, COVID's going to go away, lockdowns are going to go away, presidential elections are going to go away, whatever riffraff and unsettling things that are happening in your life, health trials, all of these things will go away. They'll be dissolved. But since all those things will be dissolved, What manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? Verse 14, therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him, capital H, in peace, without spot and blameless. Brethren, let's continue our journey in study and prayer and meditation, being led and growing in the way of peace and sharing it as we have opportunity with a world that so desperately needs it. And may the God of peace lead and guide us all as we follow him, as New Living Translation says in Luke chapter 1, verse 79, as we follow him and we're guided in the path of peace. That concludes the